Hello, in this screencast, I'm going to briefly talk about Bowen's reaction series. Now, Bowen's reaction series tells us a little bit, or a lot, about which minerals are crystallizing out of magmas at different temperatures. And that's very useful when we're trying to understand why certain types of igneous rocks have specific minerals within them. Now, Norman Bowen started to work on understanding, well, and finding out this process back in the 1920s and 1930s. He was doing research at Carnegie Institute. And what he started to do was take actual igneous rocks and he would grind them up into a powder so that they would have all of the different types of, like a combination of all the minerals that we're seeing. So the things that had quartz in it, mica, feldspar, pyroxene, olivine, amphibole, biotite, etc. So all the feldspar. So he ground these all up to make like a uniform mixture of all of these minerals. And then he started to melt them up so that he would basically create little magma melts, and he would take them up to specific temperatures. So he got them very, very hot, up to 1600 degrees Celsius. And as he started to let these materials cool down to different temperatures, he would take out a little scoop of that material and he would cool it very rapidly by putting it into a bucket of water. And so that would lock all of the minerals that were crystallizing at that temperature. He would then take those locked samples and he would go and use different ways to go and try to see what was happening. So we could use X-ray diffraction to determine which minerals were present in that little locked sample. And what he actually found out was that the minerals were crystallizing at very distinct times. So at high temperatures, he found that olivine would be crystallizing. And then as it started to cool, so we're going from high temperatures down to cool temperatures, he found in the discontinuous series that you would find olivine crystallizing. And then there's a period where both olivine and pyroxene is crystallizing. And then eventually it gets too cool that olivine stops crystallizing. And there's a little bit of overlap between pyroxene and amphibole. There's a lot of overlap between biotite and amphibole. And then when you get down to the end where we'd see potassium feldspar, then muscovite, mica, and quartz starting to crystallize at the end. Now, in the continuous series over here, that represents the plagioclase feldspar. And what he was finding is that the plagioclase would be very calcium rich. It would have more calcium within its structure at the higher temperatures. But then it was kind of this continuous gradation into becoming more sodium rich. And in fact, you could actually look at individual plagioclase crystals and find out that their centers, where they first started forming, would have more calcium, and then their outsides would have more of that sodium. So they were like zoned within individual crystal grains. So why does this whole process, why is it important? Well, it actually helps us understand a couple things. First, when we start to look at a magma as it's melting, we see at the top all of these minerals up here in this kind of light green zone have lower s amounts of silica in them than this sort of, I guess, pink band down here at the bottom. These are much higher. So as we go from the top to the bottom, we see an increase in the silica content. These are minerals that are going to be forming at high temperatures and pressures, while these are forming at lower temperatures and pressures. We have more calcium, magnesium, and iron up at the top, and we have more potassium, sodium, and silica at the bottom. And then finally, the last thing that we can kind of see is that the minerals at the top, because these are forming at high temperatures and pressures, that's where they're stable. So if you were to take all of these minerals and bring them up to the Earth's surface, olivine, pyroxene, and the calcium-rich feldspar is going to be more susceptible to weathering processes. They're going to want to more readily become clays as you start to chemically weather out all of the different minerals. Whereas quartz, which is more stable at the Earth's surface because it's associated with these lower temperatures and lower pressures for formation, is going to be more resistant to chemical weathering. So when you look at weathered sediments, we're going to see a lot more of the quartz and mica grains if we're looking at a clastic sedimentary rock, and we weren't aren't going to see lots of olivine and pyroxene unless we're at a place where that's constantly being replaced in the sediment, so it's constantly there. Okay, so one thing that's really nice is we can actually look at this whole series, and it's already banded out in this diagram to figure out what minerals would be present in different types of igneous rocks. And what we can look at here, we'll kind of look at this brown where we see the basalts and the gabbros. So this is going to be your mafic magmas that form basalts and gabbros. Now, if we look, we're going to expect to find, we can find plagioclase feldspar. We might see a little bit of amphibole. We'll see a lot of pyroxene and a little bit of olivine. Okay, peridotites are going to be mostly olivine with a little bit of pyroxene and maybe some plagioclase feldspar. Granites, on the other hand, might have a little bit of amphibole, biotite, mica, and plagioclase feldspar. They're going to have a lot more potassium feldspar, muscovite mica, and quartz. So that's what we'd be seeing down at the bottom. And then andesite's kind of in the middle. We get kind of that 50-50 composition when we're looking at intermediate magmas making andesites and diorites, some plagioclase feldspar making those lighter colored samples, some biotite mica, and some amphibole, and maybe a little bit of pyroxene. So that's just a little bit of how we can go through Bowen's reaction series. Again, trying to understand that rocks that are ultramafic are forming at high temperatures. They're going to have distinct minerals that are present, whereas our felsic igneous rocks are forming at lower temperatures and pressures, and they're also going to have their more silica-rich, sodium-rich, potassium-rich minerals that are present. So that's one way that we can use Bowen's reaction series to understand what we're seeing in our igneous rocks.